Belinda and ABC Audio present this unabridged recording of Speedy, written by Colin Thiele and read by Anna Steen.
Chapter 1. Speedy was the most beautiful dolphin in the sea. When he broke the surface in a swift arc, his skin shone, and the water fell from his body like flakes of light. From the bow of his father's boat, Mike could look down and watch every movement Speedy made. His sudden sweeps to left and right, the fast, strong thrust of his tail, his great curving leaps out of the water. He seemed to swim and gambol for the sheer joy of it. Mike was sure that most of the time, Speedy had a grin on his face. Mike was only 5 years old when his adventure with Speedy began. He was out on his father's fishing cutter, Swordfish, one day, a little boy who could never sit still and who was always running from stem to stern or fooling about with hooks and lines. This day, as he ran along the deck, he tripped over a coil of rope. Without a moment's warning, he pitched headlong over the port side and into the sea. The boat was moored in 9 or 10 metres of water in the lee of Pebble Point, sheltering from the sea wind. Small waves were running with the swell, slapping and sucking at the hull. Mike's father, Ben, was crouching behind the wheelhouse, splicing a broken mooring rope. He was working so intently that he didn't see Mike fall, and he didn't hear the splash of his body as it hit the water. At that age, Mike couldn't swim very well. In any case, he was winded by the fall and confused by the sudden shock of cold water closing over his head. It seemed certain that he would drown. But at that moment, something amazing happened. A grey form shot round the cutter at lightning speed, curved upwards, and rose straight out of the sea in a great burst of shining water. It was a dolphin. The strength and speed of its uprush carried it high beside the starboard railing where Ben was working. Its head was almost level with his shoulder. He started with astonishment at the sight of this sea creature suddenly catapulting up to within a metre or two of his left ear. At the same time, the dolphin was making an urgent sound, a snickering, nickering kind of sound that suggested danger and alarm. Ben stood up hastily, still astonished, just as the dolphin crashed back into the water. Instantly, it darted round to the port side, as if in a race between life and death. To this day, Mike and his father swear that what they say about the next few seconds is true. Mike was floundering near the surface, flailing feebly with his arms and swallowing lots of salt water. His ears were ringing and he was starting to lose consciousness. As he began to sink, a long cigar-shaped form swept in underneath him, butted its head against the small of his back and flung him into the air. Almost at once he sank again, but a second time he was lifted and tossed up. He managed to let out a gurgling cry just as Ben came running from the far side of the boat, shouting, "Mike! Mike!" Ben dived overboard, swam desperately to the spot where Mike was floundering, and seized him under the armpits. Luckily, a dinghy was moored behind their cutter, so Ben was able to push him into it, and from there he lifted him back on board. It took an hour or more for both of them to recover from the shock, but at last, dried and dressed in warm clothes, they were able to sit quietly in the galley, drinking cups of hot cocoa. Ben was still shaking his head in bewilderment. "I don't believe it," he said. "That dolphin knew you were in danger. It really knew." Mike stared silently into his cup. "It wanted to warn me," Ben went on. Mike looked up.
"It did more than that, Dad," he answered.
For Mike was sure he could still feel the pressure of the dolphin's nose against the small of his back, pushing him up into the open air.
Chapter 2. The following day, when Mike and his father were sailing out to the fishing grounds, a dolphin appeared, not far from the spot where Mike had fallen overboard.
"That's him!" Mike called excitedly. "That's him, all right!"
Ben shook his head. "You can't be sure, son. They all look alike." Mike seized a few fish that he had caught from the jetty earlier that morning and threw them to the dolphin. The effect was astounding. The dolphin seemed to understand that this was Mike's way of saying thank you, and it stood vertically half out of the water with its head up, nodding and grinning like an old friend. Ben laughed. "I think you're right, Mike," he said. "He seems to know you." "I reckon it is the same fellow."
After that, the dolphin went into ecstasy. It flashed about near the boat at the speed of a bullet, arching up in long, smooth curves, plunging down joyously, sweeping past the bow again and again, as if impatient at the slow pace of human beings. Mike watched with shining eyes.
"Isn't he beautiful?" he said. "Just look at him go, Dad, like a rocket."
"Yeah, I wish I could swim like that."
"Really fast."
"Speedy."
Mike looked up with a grin.
"That's a good name for him, Dad."
"Yeah, I guess it is."
So Speedy it was. That was the beginning of a special friendship between Speedy and Mike. Speedy seemed able to recognise swordfish instantly, distinguishing her from all the other boats in the Gulf and around the shores of Kangaroo Island. On most days, as soon as Mike and Ben sailed out of the narrow entrance to Pebble Bay, he was there to meet them, cavorting joyfully. Speedy was a bottlenose dolphin. His arched forehead and rounded nose showed that plainly enough. His skin was grey-green above and creamy white along the underbelly. Although he was at least 2 metres long and probably weighed several hundred kilograms, his strong tail and big fin made him always true to his name. He had a nostril, a crescent-shaped blowhole, on top of his head, and sometimes he blew air out of it noisily, as if trying to imitate a whale. Mike was sure he could recognise Speedy anywhere, even in the middle of a school of other dolphins, but his father laughed at that. Mike insisted.
"They're just like people, Dad," he said. "They might look roughly the same, but each one is different."
Ben still scoffed. "You could fool me."
"It's true. It's not just his face. It's the way he acts and everything."
"His personality?"
"Yeah."
Ben smiled doubtingly. "Well, maybe."
"You'll see," Mike answered. "You'll see, all right."
During the next 5 years, Speedy became famous. He liked to lead swordfish right into the harbour at Pebble Bay, swimming ahead like a pathfinder, diving and gambling jubilantly. Everyone up and down the coast knew about him.
"That's young Mike Flint's dolphin," they would say if they caught a glimpse of Speedy. "Carries on like a sheepdog." Sometimes tourists wanted to go out on swordfish so they could see Speedy's antics.
"Are you Ben Flint?" they'd ask Mike's father. "How much does it cost to see the show?"
People like that made Ben angry. "It's not a circus," he'd answer sourly. "I don't train animals. I'm a fisherman. One of my son's best friends just happens to be a dolphin."
Most of the people in Pebble Bay liked Speedy, and they didn't mind if crowds of tourists came over in the summer months to see him. Visitors spent money at the cafe where Mike's mother worked, or at the gift shop, or the petrol station, and that was good for the town. But there were a few fishermen who hated Speedy and all his kind. They called them underwater thieves
and accused them of stealing the fish out of their nets and frightening away schools of salmon and snapper. They said the same thing about seals and sharks and rays and all other sea creatures that interfered with their greedy ways. Boris Butler was the worst grumbler of all. He was a big, bull-shouldered man who always wore...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.